all aspirants, welcome to this channel. I am Naresh Kollimalla, presently working as a senior geologist in ONGC. So today this video is about joint CSIR UGC NET exam for earth sciences category. First I would like to mention that this video is definitely helpful for other category people in the earth sciences also, but this video is mostly targeted for geology students, so please keep note of it. So in this video we are going to look about the basics about what is joint CSIR UGC NET exam, and in that the exam criteria, nature, the questions, how things are going to be there for earth sciences category, and then where to collect and how to collect material and how to prepare material and the important books, and what is the examiner's psychology like, what is the standard of examiners and what is the standard of paper, and in what way questions are being asked, and how we should approach, and why, how we can understand the nature of examiner we are going to look, and lastly the time management, like while sitting in the exam hall, how we can manage the time and all, how to go about the exam, we are going to see. Let's look into it. So joint CSIR UGC NET exam is a national level exam which is being conducted twice in a year, in June and in December. And CSIR is Council for Scientific and Industrial Research, which looks after and which controls most of the research organizations in India. And as we all know that UGC is Universities Grants Commission, which looks after all universities in India, and NET is National Eligibility Test. This year the responsibility of conducting this exam is given to NTA, National Testing Agency, so it is being taken up by that organization, and it is being floated. So this exam is mainly to determine the eligibility for Junior Research Fellowship, JRF, and for lectureship and assistant professorship also. And one can apply for both JRF and lectureship, or only for lectureship also, depending upon their eligibility and age. Those factors have to be seen. And those who qualify for JRF automatically gets eligible for lectureship or assistant professorship, or some aspirants would be declared successful for only lectureship and assistant professorship only, depending upon their age, depending upon their performance in examination. And let's come to educational qualification. For science students, it is MSc is mandatory, MSc should be qualified. And for geology students, any MSc geology degree would be sufficient to apply for this examination. And the one who is awaiting the result also is eligible to apply for this exam. And age, for JRF, the upper age limit is 28 years for general category candidate. And for OBC, 3 years relaxation is there. And for SCST, and for female candidates, and for physically handicapped candidates, another 5 years exemption is given. And comes to stipend. If any fellow qualifies for JRF and if he opts for JRF fellowship, he can get 31,000 rupees for 2 years for every month, along with another 20,000 rupees contingent fund per year. So after finishing 2 years, depending upon like a constituent committee will be formed, and it would be decided upon whether his stipend or his fund should be continued or not. If he is successful in that, and he can be taken as SRF, and the stipend would be 35,000 rupees per month from that period. And the validity of the exam, the validity of the fellowship is very important thing one should consider. After qualifying for JRF, within 2 years it should be utilized. The JRF fellowship Again, I am repeating, the JRF fellowship to be utilized within 2 years. And for lecturership, as I have mentioned, there is no upper age limit and validity depending upon, like for an example, if they want to apply for any lecturership and assistant professorship, only their age limit for that post would be considered. So, technically speaking, there is no particular age limit as mentioned. And these details are very common details, very general details. And for more details, you can visit the site csrnet.nti.nic.in. So, let's look into the other slides. So, this slide is about the pattern of examination for earth sciences. And as we can see here, the paper is divided into three parts, part A, part B and part C. Part A is common for all papers, for all subjects. And in part A, there would be total 20 questions, each question carrying 2 marks and 0.5 negative mark would be there for any negative answer, which is 33% of the each question. And out of 20 questions, one should answer 15 questions. So 5 questions is choice. And this part B is generally general aptitude like reasoning and numerical ability and graphical analysis. So these things are part of part A. And then comes to part B. This one can say as the basic questions, the basic subject belongs to this part. And here total 50 questions would be given. Each question would be carrying 2 marks and only 35 questions should be answered. And in part C is the part where candidate's analytical abilities, subject depth and his application of the subject to the problems would be analyzed. So this part is also very important and this tests actually candidates' depth of the subject knowledge. So here 80 questions would be given, like out of 80 only 25 to be answered and each question carries 4 marks. So like rest are choice. Like why only out of 80 questions, why only 25 in the sense? Because this constitutes earth, atmospheric, ocean and planetary sciences. Here not just geology, geophysics, meteorology, oceanography, bits also would be there in good quantity. So only 25 questions should be answered. So a total 150 questions would be given and out of it only 75 should be answered. So 50% choice is there. In part C choice is more, in part B choice is bit less and in part A choice is bit more less. So let's go. This is about earth, atmospheric, ocean and planetary sciences, as we can collectively call as earth sciences. So here it consists of two parts, part B and part C. Part B consists of 5 units. This is the syllabus of the part C, part B. So there are 5 units: earth and solar system, earth material, surface features and processes, interior of the earth, deformation and tectonics, environmental sciences and oceans and atmosphere. If you see very clearly, if you see deeply into it, what we can understand that we can subdivide or we can classify these all 5 units into 3 categories, like geology and environmental geology as one category, basic geophysics as another category, basic oceanography and basic meteorology as one more category. So here around 70 marks this part is carrying and all are basic questions and all. And this part mostly for geology student it is boon. Mostly like most of the questions, dominant questions comes from geology and other parts also like basics only, basic geophysics and basics meteorology and oceanography, they are mostly related or somewhat very near to us. So it is very important not to miss, not to lose, not to leave anything from part B for geology students. So let's go to part C. Part C in totality consists of 5 major units. One is geology, physical geography, geophysics, meteorology, ocean sciences. My sincere advice for geology students to take up geology and physical geography both. Here, forget about geophysics, meteorology and ocean sciences. From these bits, any basic bits comes where we cannot able to comfortably answer entire 25 questions. The basic bits from these 3 sections can be utilized because already we have read something about this oceanography, meteorology and geophysics as part of part B, so that would be utilized. But here, one should solely concentrate on geology and physical geography only, and we should not leave these two. And now we'll see what is there in geology, what geology constitutes. In geology, we can see as subject wise, we can divide them: mineralogy and petrology, structural geology, geotectonics, paleontology, sedimentology, stratigraphy, marine geology, geochemistry, economic geology, and mineral exploration also can be clubbed here. And Precambrian geology, along with quaternary geology. In applied geology, hydrogeology, remote sensing, and engineering geology are there. So these are all the major subjects in geology. So all subjects we are going to look. And in physical geography, environmental geography, geography of India, basic climatology, physical geomorphology is there. Like most of it relates to us, so it is good that we read this part also, because some bits may be coming from this section also, so it is useful for us. Now we look at the scheme, look at the exam, look at the question scheme. This is planning of preparation and nature of material. So let's look here. The most important thing is one should be more dependent, and one should have much clarity on the basics. So basics are very important. So before dwelling deep into the subjects, one should try to acquire a basic knowledge about all the subjects. That is very important. First, stick to the basics, go through the basics, and the material should be concise, crisp, and to the point. Because we can see the syllabus is very lengthy, it is very difficult to accommodate all the, like for an example, you see, for mineralogy there are tens of books, and one lifetime is also not enough for studying entire mineralogy in detail. That is known. So, but here it is a strategy, it is an effort to clear an exam. So, we should be very clear, to be precise, to be concise and crisp. So, whatever material we collect, whatever the content we do have, to be precise in good manner, and in should have good content also. So mostly encyclopedias offer such type of content, like Encyclopedia of Earth Sciences, Encyclopedia of Meteorology and Oceanography, or Atmospheric Sciences are available. So one can go through them to make short notes. Otherwise, and NCERT geography books also very much helpful. But for Part B, as I can see, from NAT also we can get a lot of material. But the way how it should be taken is, topic wise, like let's take one unit, unit 1, unit 2, unit 3 and 4, take one unit, take all the topics and all, topic wise collect the material and all one by one, and you keep it as you progress, you collect all the material topic wise one by one. Internet also one can use very well. And for Part C, as we were discussing, geology and physical geography was there. Here what happens? For Part C, encyclopedia doesn't help much. It will be useful only, but not to the point. And in this case, to have more knowledge and to look at the applicative way, one should read subject-wise books, and internet also one can utilize well. So I hope everyone knows subject-wise books. In coming slides, what are the subject-wise books I have mentioned, so one can take a screenshot of it. So as topic-wise you are moving up, collect material. And one more important thing I would like to mention here, with no offense, generally in state universities what happens, most of the topics are not very deeply covered and all, and the material given is also not to the standard with which one can clear NET and GATE. So please don't totally depend on university material, and particularly for those people who use Bangar and equivalent books of engineering geology for every competitive exam, I would like to suggest, please don't utilize such type of books, don't use such type of books, and use subject-wise books. And one more important thing is, work out on previous papers thoroughly. Like for an example, from the year 2011, papers are available online, you can find. 2011 and 12 hard copies only available. From 2012 onwards, papers are available except for 2013 December and 2014 June and 2019 December. Around 14 papers are available online. So one can take all the papers and one can segregate the bits in the papers. Subject wise, as I have mentioned before, in part B there are 3 main categories and in part C there are around 10 main categories. Category wise, subject wise, one can segregate the bits. At the end, subject wise, one can segregate the bits, and together bits and subject and syllabus together one can prepare. That is more useful, like a few of our friends are doing it right now. And while you are preparing, look at formulas, look at problems, look at charts, utilize them well, use them well, read them well. That would be better. And this is what about this slide. These are some of the important books. One can take the screenshot of it, and you can find these books online also. And let's go to the next slide. From which section, how many questions are coming? So here, look at carefully. This is part B. You need geology, environmental geology, basic geophysics, basic meteorology, basic oceanography. And in part C, geology and physical geography. So this column, total number of questions asked, number of questions to be answered, number of questions coming from each section, and total marks of the paper, and marks coming from geology alone. So here, from environmental geology, total questions 50 for part B, and we have to answer 35. And this analogy I have made from 2015 and 2016 June and December papers. I have analyzed those papers, and this is the analogy. And for most of the papers, it would be more or less like same only. So from environmental geology and geology, 26 to 29 bits are coming. From geophysics, 6 to 9 bits. Basic meteorology, 6 to 7 bits. Basic oceanography, 9 to 11 bits are coming. So from geology alone, 26 to 29 bits are coming. So we have to answer 35 bits. This subjects also very basic. So if you prepare all the subjects together, we can comfortably answer 35 questions, which can be carrying full marks. So that is useful. And here, in part C, from geology and physical geography, out of 80 questions, around 25 to 27 questions are coming from geology, and from physical geography, 6 to 8 questions are coming. So in total, around 32 to 35 questions probably coming from geology and physical geography together, where we have to answer only 25 questions. Since this part is a bit tricky and a bit difficult, so even if you are not able to, if anyone not able to answer all questions from geology alone, he can answer from physical geology. If any questions from basic questions coming from basic oceanography, meteorology, geophysics also, we can answer because we have studied those subjects as part of part B. So please keep a note of these things. Go to the next slide. So in geology, how many questions are coming? So in geology, these are the subjects we have classified: general geology and physical geology, which is not given in the syllabus, but this is what I have done. So this way it would be easier. Geology and physical geology were weathering and fluvial systems and geomorphic features, everything is coming. Mineralogy, petrology, structural geology, paleontology, sedimentology and stratigraphy, marine geology, geochemistry, economic geology, and applied geology, these are all the main things. And here I have given how many questions are coming from each section. One can see here, from geology, physical geology, mineralogy and petrology, structural geology, sedimentology, geochemistry, and applied geology, remote sensing and hydrogeology problems, many questions are coming. So we should work on it. Geology, we should not leave any subject, we should work on all subjects. So please make note of it. So here also important topics I tried to mention in general geology: weathering, chemical alterations of secondary minerals, fluvial systems, deltaic systems, and landforms. Geomorphic features are important in mineralogy: silicate structure, solid solutions, series. Solid solution series comes under petrology also. Secondary mineral alterations, mineral chemistry are important in petrology: melts, phase behaviors, thermodynamics, rock textures, associated tectonisms, PT diagrams, pressure temperature diagrams in sedimentology, textural characters, structures, transportation mechanisms, depositional environments, depositional setups and their mechanisms are important. Stratigraphy, one should concentrate on Indian stratigraphic units and their correlations. And in geochemistry, isotopic applications are mostly important. And in economic geology, physical and chemical nature of mineral deposits. And in applied geology, mostly groundwater problems, infiltration, aquifer related problems like specific yield, porosity, specific retention, those problems are coming. And in basic remote sensing, basics of remote sensing is also important. So these are all the important topics I try to figure out, so please keep note of it. This is also a very important criteria: time management in exam hall. How one should manage his time in exam hall? This slide explains that well. First, give time to read questions, which is very important. So there is a strategy in it. What happens, 50% clearing these exams is time management only. 50% is preparation and 50% is time management. So I'll try to tell you how to go about. First, take part B, go through it, just have a look at it, take 10 minutes, go through it, just have a look, and decide upon what are the 35 questions you are most likely going to answer out of 50 questions. You take 10 minutes, then you answer part B in two phases. In phase one, take most confident questions. Those are direct, those are short, those are simple, those are very close to your heart. So answer them well. And then phase two, take lengthy questions, slightly doubtful questions. So answer them, save them, submit them if you are very sure. Save them if you are a bit doubtful, or your benefit of doubt is around 10%. Use 50 to 55 minutes for the both phases. So positively, you should be finishing this task by 1 hour. And one more important thing is, never ever tempted to answer doubtful questions. Negative marking is very dangerous. Don't answer doubtful questions. Okay. So let's go to the part C section. Here also we have to answer 25 questions out of 80. So again, go through it. Mostly like 71 to 121 number questions will pop up for this subject, geology and geomorphology. Go through all the questions. Again, take 10 minutes. Note down what are the 25 questions you are going to answer. Repeat the process in two phases, like the way you have done for part B. So solve, take 90 minutes, and you have got 20 minutes left. Now go to part A, solve as many as questions possible in 15 minutes. So you have got another 5 minutes, and now you surely go back and you save your questions. What questions you have kept doubtfully before, you save those questions positively. So this is the criteria one should follow, strategy one should follow. So I would like to mention some other important aspect of this presentation. Like any reasonable man would like to know that what is the cutoff mark to qualify for this exam. Means like out of 200 marks, how many marks if any candidate needed to qualify for JRF and to qualify for lecturership or assistant professorship. Before that, be clear that cutoff marks would not be known, would not be mentioned before the examination. Cut-off marks would be knowing at the time of exam results declaration only. Cut-off marks decides by the authority depending upon the number of JRFs per year in each category they would like to provide, and depending upon the reservation category also. So by accommodating all these things, the reservation category and the number of JRFs they would want to present for that year, they will decide the cutoff marks, and they will see accordingly, they will make it. And this data what I have presented here, this is for Earth Sciences, for Junior Research Fellow and for lecturership for the year 2019, December. So here one can see that for a general candidate, almost like 65% marks he needs. So it is almost equal to around 130 marks. And OBC candidate needs around 115 marks. SC candidate needs around 98 marks. And ST candidate needs around 89 or 90 marks to qualify for JRF and for lecturership. So they need a bit less marks. So for unreserved candidate, it is something like 115 marks. And for OBC candidate, it is something like 110 marks. And then SC, ST candidate, so on. Still less marks and all. So make a thumb rule. For any general candidate, he needs to get around 60 to 65% of marks to get qualified. It would be equal to 120 to 130 marks. And for more information, you can visit the site which I have mentioned earlier. Go to that site and you can see previous year's cutoff marks, so you can get an idea. And thank you very much, and I wish you all the best for your successful preparation, and do hard work, and you will get results. Thank you.